Good evening, how are we?
Good.
You can make as much noise as you like, we don't care. Now what can we say about the SuperJesus? They are super, amen, they are an amazing band. Formed right here in Adelaide in 1994 out of Hell's Kitchen. Their debut album Sumo went to number 2, Gen Age went to number 5, and Rock Music got to number 14. They've won ARIA Awards for Best New Talent and Breakthrough Artist in 1997. The album Sumo won Best Rock Album in 98. And here we are, 20 years later. They're about to become Hall of Famers. Please welcome the great Sarah McLeod and Stuart Rudd from the SuperJesus. SuperJesus, and I thought, Jesus, this band better be super, because it was initially it was a bit of a piss take, the name, wasn't it?
It's a rather ostentatious name, don't you think? Yes,
yes.
I do agree. I think that was what we were trying to go for at the beginning. We thought, we'll just tell them we're good. We'll just tell them we're good. What are they going to do? Say no?
And then you showed them. There was an obsession with Jesus in the 90s, wasn't there? There were bands like Jesus James, the Jesus Lizard. Jesus and Mary Jane.
Yep, we toured with most of these bands too.
Yes, and so who came up with the name?
Actually, Chris did. Chris, the guy who's not here tonight, is our first guitarist. It was a combination of just say all of the sort of buzzwords at the time of, you know, the bands that we liked. And everyone was doing it in the 90s, you know, so we thought we'll just get all the like cool words that everyone banters around and chuck it together as one word. We'll throw a V in front of it so it sounds like we mean business, like the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, the SuperJesus. And that was it.
And it worked. It worked. We've got to talk about Chris. We've got to talk about Chris Cannon, because he was a bit of a veteran on the scene at the time, and he was your guitar teacher.
He was. Actually, Stuart knew him for years before before Chris and I met. They were in a band together. What was it called? A band you're in? We used to punish Peavy. What's your band?
I think it was Hell's Kitchen.
Actually. Oh, that's right. It was Hell's Kitchen. And we nicked the name.
Yeah, we did.
Original, creative. Yeah. Yeah, so you, did you introduce me to him?
God. I'm not too sure who it was, but we ended up, yeah, getting Chris in the band.
Yeah, he was in a band with Stuart, I think, yeah, Hell's Kitchen, and then I was in Fallen Down Monster. Chris was my guitar teacher, and then one thing led to another, and he said, I think you've got potential, young lady. Raw talent, he used to call me, which basically meant, I like you, but, you know, you've got shortcomings. Raw talent, not talented enough yet, but you will be when I'm finished with you. So that was his way of keeping me, you know, here, so... we played together a bit, and then he said, yeah, I wouldn't mind playing in a band with you. And at that time, because he had been in this... Is this too long an answer?
Continue.
Well, yeah. He'd been in this band called Almost Human, who were quite successful in Adelaide as a cover band. And so everyone wanted to know what Chris was doing next, you know? So when he said that he would play in a band with me, I was like, ooh, this is exciting, because, you know, he was some sort of rock star around town. And then, yeah, so you and I were already in a band.
Yeah, well, were we? What was that called?
Fallen Down Monster.
Boom.
That's right, I only joined Fallen Down Monster.
I think we actually got kicked out. We were barred from a few places too, I think.
I think you were barred. I was pretty good. I was actually...
You were part of it.
Yeah, I didn't do anything wrong.
Anyways, that ended that band. Yeah. We couldn't play anymore.
Our incessant barring was the death of us.
So, how old were you when Chris was teaching you guitar at this stage?
I think I would have been 23, 22, or I don't know. How old are you? It's rude to ask a lady how old she is. Were you nuts?
I'm 25, so we're working upwards. But the thing is, he's teaching you guitar, and then all of a sudden he says he wants to form this band with you. So he obviously saw the potential, right?
He must have taught me too much. Something was going on. We got along well, obviously, and that was weird. And then we started writing songs together, and it was like School of Rock with him. Like, he was such a hard ass, and he would make me rewrite songs over and over and over. And to be honest, it was a nightmare and extraordinarily painful. And I don't know if I would ever do it again. Or, having said that, I am doing it again. But you know, I'm a glutton for punishment. But it's hard work writing with him. And but it took us like a year to write those songs, maybe more.
You said he was tough on you.
He was so tough on me. Yeah.
In hindsight, was that a good thing or a bad thing?
Oh, it was a great thing. Yeah, because I learned everything I know about guitar from him. Otherwise, I probably would still be in Fall of Our Monster playing at the Kentown doing Hooter Gurus covers. Not there's anything wrong with Hooter Gurus, but you just don't need to hear me singing them.
Hindsight's a wonderful thing. Do you look back and think, apart from Chris Cannon, who had been around for a while, you were basically just kids having a go, and suddenly you became the SuperJesus. And at the time, were you thinking, this is a little bit too easy, or had you worked really hard to get there? What was your thought process at that stage? Because you're young, you're both, you know, like, you know, and then all of a sudden you're in this band that's making it.
We worked 18 months in a rehearsal room, and it was a year, 7 days a week. And it's interesting that we get approached by young people who ask, geez, you're lucky. You know, we hear that a lot. You know, you guys are pretty lucky. We'll go, well, you know, the harder we worked, the luckier we got. So, and that was really...
There's nothing really that lucky about it. It was hard. It was really hard. Those days were hard.
We'll know that tonight. You know, there's birthdays and all sorts that we missed. But
our families suffered. Yeah. We didn't even have homes. We were never long enough to have a home. I slept on my Auntie Jenny's floor for like ages. Yeah, you know, my sister had kids and I didn't hardly see them growing up because I was always on tour. You make a lot of sacrifices.
And I think Sarah's being a little bit modest because Chris obviously saw how much talent she had at a very young age. So
how come your mic's way louder than ours?
Because I'm better looking than you. And we can lie all night if you like, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay, I need some more lipstick.
So you were together initially for 10 years.
Yeah.
And you said yourself that it was a difficult band to be in. Now, why was that? But look, most bands are, aren't they?
Actually, no. When we were touring, I used to look at all the other bands like Grinspoon and Jebediah and everyone that was on the same scene as us. And they always looked like it was just easy street for them. But it was difficult in our band because the dynamic was weird. Like, Paul and Ruddy were lovely, but Chris and I had a very strange dynamic, and he, God love it, we love him, but he was, he didn't always want to be there, so it made it sort of, there was ups and downs about, you know, each gig. Like, sometimes if he didn't want to be at a gig, like, because he and I used to fight a lot, so sometimes if he and I were fighting, the gig would always actually be really good, but like, he's been known to just, if I'm standing here singing, he'll just stand in front of me and just play his guitar, like, just glaring at people. And I'm standing behind him going... there were some really, really weird times. We've actually got a few video clips where he's just standing in front of me, glaring down the camera. And I'm, like, hanging behind him going, that's all right, they'll find me in the end. We'll just rewind it.
And you were at this stage, you were in a relationship with him, which you always...
Who told you that?
You did.
When did I tell you that?
Just then.
No, I didn't. What, is this the guilty face?
No, but so...
That's not really common knowledge. Did I tell you that?
No, I know that. That's my job.
Anyway, yeah. Well, I'm not going to bring out your past indiscretions, am I?
Feel free. So whatever you like. I don't care. But did that make it doubly hard when you were actually in a relationship with this guy?
Yeah, it totally did. Because we kept it from everyone for years. Because he said to me that... I can't believe I'm talking about this here. This is so embarrassing. He was like, we can't tell anyone because then the rest of the band will think that that's why, you know, you're siding with me on this idea or whatever. I was like, yeah, whatever. Anyway, so that caused problems. Can we not talk about this? This is embarrassing.
Yeah. I'll tell you what it did do.
That's what we're here for.
I'll tell you what it did do. It created a great energy in the songwriting.
There you go, Ruddy. Yes.
So that's what it did do.
Yes. Yeah. It did. There was an energy. Yeah.
Now, have you heard the famous Pete Townsend quote about the Who? Have you heard this quote?
No, but I think it's about to.
I want you to both comment on this. Townsend said basically, being in a rock band is being with a group of people who have nothing in common with each other except they're in a band that plays rock.
Yeah, well, we're all from different sides of the tracks.
Absolutely, I agree.
It's like cracking rocks on a chain gang. Couldn't think of anything I'd rather do.
The Who were the ultimate example of that. They were fighting all the time, so...
The fighting actually gives you the good chemistry, I think.
I think so.
Although, having said that, like, we're all really good friends these days, and it's awesome. So, you know, there's merit to both sides. But sometimes there's spirit in the turbulence.
Okay, so you were together for 10 years and you didn't officially break up.
No, we just kind of waddled away.
But why? What happened?
Remember that time we went to London?
Back.
Tell them about that.
Tell us about it, Stuart.
No, we don't need to go there. We went for the wine festival, the Australian Wine Festival, over there in the UK. And we drank wine and we didn't stop. And the next minute, we're on a plane home.
Next minute, there is no man.
Next minute, we're in trouble.
So was there a huge explosion, or was it just a dissipation, or what was it?
There was an emotional explosion, yes.
But that's what you get when you tour. That's being part of a band. That is, you know, you have it with your siblings. I'm sure, you know, people out there fight and all
that.
It's
like a marriage.
Yeah, that's right. And you're working, you lack of sleep. You're hungry, you're working all the time, and that's what happens. And that's what happened to us.
So do you hate each other now?
No, we've been through the ringer together. We have been through the ringer, and now we're just like so happy that we're still here, and now we just love each other.
Give a round of applause, come on.
That's the beauty of a recovery circle.
That's the beauty of rock and roll.
I wouldn't have it any other way.
And that's the beauty of bands. Now, Sarah, you released a solo album, Beauty Was a Tiger, in 2005. And what did you do, Stuart, when the band broke up?
I worked with Nick Barker. I did some tours with Nick Barker, and I ended up producing an Adelaide band called The Gels. So I did, you know, kept myself busy, pretty much.
And Sarah, after an illustrious solo career, another band called Screaming Bikini in 2011. SuperJesus reformed in 2013. How did that come about?
Well, we had no plans to get back together, but Paul just came back from Washington and called us and said, I'm home. And we're like, cool, what are you calling me for? Oh, I know, that's right, we're still in band. Because, you know, I'm not very good at hanging out with people for no reason. Oh, let's go for lunch. Why? I don't know, hungry. No, we need a reason to hang out. It'd be great to see Ruddy again. We need a reason for this. So we thought we'd just put on a one-off show. Just one. So we rehearsed, we did a show at the Gov, and we thought we'll see how it goes. We'll see, A, if we like each other, which we did. B, if you guys liked us, which you did.
Yes, round of applause. Come on, give me a round of applause, please.
And then, you know, one thing led to another, and now we're getting medals.
Cool. Very shortly, you'll get those in a minute.
Yeah, where's my medal?
You toured with a Tea Party in 2014, Baby Animals in 2015. Now, that must have been a buzz.
Oh, totally. They're good friends of ours, so... we've never played with them, we've seen them a lot, but we've known them for a long time, and kindred spirits, similar sort of kind of band, and the two bands together were like smoking. That was a really good tour. So yeah, we had fun.
And you released the EP Love and Violence last year. Will there be more touring, more recording?
There will be more touring and there will be more recording. I think now we've got the ball rolling, we're just you know, like, we've been through the, oh, let's stop for a while, but now we'll just do it till we die. Like, there's just no reason to stop, so, you know. Yeah, even if you guys stop behind the records and you don't like us anymore, we'll still do it anyway. We'll just play it to our mums and our dogs and stuff.
It's not going to happen. Look, Sarah, I can remember seeing you on Rock Wiz. Now, did anybody see the Rock Wiz episode with Sarah and Angry Anderson? Can you see that? And you know those collaborations they do on Rock Wiz, and sometimes they're good.
I'm familiar with them, Pembo, yes.
Yes, I know you are, because you were part of it. But what I'm saying is some of them are a bit hit and miss, but that collaboration was extraordinary.
That was a good one, hey.
What was... did you do one rehearsal for that, or had you done it before, or...
No, I'd never played it before. There was no rehearsal, but we did do a sound check. We ran out of sound check, and I said, I'll sing this bit, you sing that bit. We didn't really know the words, and there was the sound check, though, because I remember being nervous, because I said, I'm going to play the guitar solo, and I didn't really know what I was doing. And so that was, I was more worried about the guitar solo than anything. Which I nailed, by the way.
Absolutely nailed. And there's another clip on YouTube.
Yeah.
You've got to see the other clip on YouTube where, I don't know, where are you playing with that? Is it in Sydney, the other clip, and you're on stage in Sydney somewhere?
With Angry?
With Angry.
That is at the Enmore Theatre.
And I don't know if you've seen it, but you got Angus down, girlfriend. It is unbelievable. It is just fantastic. It really is.
Thanks,
Magnus.
Thank
you. I'm sure the old St. Peter's Collegiate Girls School would be very, very proud of you. You actually got something out of your education.
This is my speech night.
Sarah McLeod and Stuart Rudd, welcome to the AMC South Australian Music Hall of Fame. And we've got a standard, Sarah, this is your medal. You finally got the medal.
Thank you, Pembo.
Stuart, this is yours. You got the plaque here, recognition by your peers for the SuperJesus. This is what days of our lives, isn't it? And this is for you.
That's like the Olympics.
Thank you.
And we've got some plaques here as well.
Thank you very much.
I know they're not here, but we have to acknowledge Chris Tennant, recognition by your peers. Can you pass that on to Chris, or don't you talk anymore?
Yeah, no, we're talking.
Okay, good. And also a plaque for Paul Berryman. Okay, so you take that, Stuart. Please give a round of applause. Sarah
McLeod.
They finally got the medal. And they'll be back shortly to play for you in about 10 minutes' time. Please give it up for Sarah McLeod. Sure, love from the SuperJesus. Yes, put it on. Yeah. We were going to have Rob Riley, yeah. But he's not well.
I'm going to wear this everywhere.
She's going to wear it on the tram home.
I'm going to wear this to Bunnings, to the supermarket, to Petmark, to the local delicatessen, and everywhere you go, I'm going to follow you with this medal.
Thank you very much. We'll be back shortly, and they'll be playing for you with the string quartet. Thank you, guys.
Thanks, guys. Get up!
I remember recording Sumo as a time of great creativity from all involved. The players were truly talented at their craft, and the songs do not sound dated. They stand the test of time. Not only were the players awesome, they were all really nice, thoughtful people. The story I will share has to do with donuts. One of the band, either Stuart or Paul, discovered an Atlanta, Georgia legend in the way of a donut shop called Krispy Kreme. I was told by them they could not get these tasty treats in Australia. Two of them were so in love with the taste of the donuts, they admitted to hiding them from the others and keeping the door to their room locked as to hoard the treats from Sarah and Chris. It was a big laugh for me and them as I grew up knowing of the magic that is Krispy Kreme. Especially when the hot sign is lit at the stores, as the donuts are fresh out of the fryer at that point. I remember having an exciting time working on the record, as they were the first Aussie band I'd worked with. I am proud to have shared in that part of the band's career, and I'm equally as proud to share in a small part their inclusion into the South Australian Music Hall of Fame. Best wishes to Sarah, Stuart and the band, and ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome SuperJesus.
So this is obviously the most highbrow event that I've ever, no, when I say obviously, you don't know that, but this is the most highbrow event I've ever attended, let alone played it. I thought we were going to play on the steps of the State Library, so forgive me if I gave everybody a bum steer because I told everybody in the press and all over my social media that we were outside in the gutter.
I'm here every week, by the way.
What, just catching up on some light reading? I did see them, yeah. There's so much action going on outside. And they've got their own thing happening. They don't need us.
State number 32 is reading, by the way.
Ready? Yeah, so we're doing mostly songs from Sumo, I think, tonight.
And the guy that sent that telegram that they just heard before, that was really sweet. That was the sound engineer who we absolutely loved and haven't spoken to in like 20 years. I didn't think he would even remember who we were. Let alone send us a telegram. Was that a telegram? People don't send telegrams anymore, do they? They should. I think we should bring back telegrams. Do you think we'll get some sort of telegram from the Queen? Alright, what song are we doing now? Oh, stay. Okay. Okay. Okay, sorry, I just had to retune. I am ready! very much. Thank you for coming, by the way. I know this is like a weird gig to come to. It's an interesting gig. And you guys came out and bought tickets and everything. And that's cool as. Rad. Thanks, man. All of you. Collective man. That's you guys. Yeah, thank you very much for your time. I appreciate it. Alright, sweet, rock song. This is our last song, yeah. This is our last song, but it is without a doubt one of the proudest moments of my life sitting up here tonight. And thank you for coming and joining us for this fun occasion. And yeah, thanks, fellas. Thanks, Ray. Thanks, Mick. Thanks, Jason. Thank you, Enrico, for having us here, and the State Library for letting us hang out with all of this knowledge. I can't read, so I'm going to get out of here as soon as I put the guitar down. Thank you.
Over the years, and that's the press and the families and everybody else.
The cops.
Thank you very much. And all the people who have played and all the bands that we've played with, thank you very much.
And all the people who have played in our band over the years, because we've had a lot of lineup changes. So everyone that's come and gone within our lineup, let's give them a round of applause as well.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, that's it. Thank you very much for supporting us. Thank you for coming along. Thanks to the State Library for giving us the venue and providing the money to make it work. And we really do thank them. We need that as much as possible. I probably feel a bit aggrieved that we don't still do the regular shows at Goodwood, but of course, you know, we need the money to be able to support that sort of thing. But having said that, I want you to thank Super Jesus one more time, please. And all the other acts that came along and played this evening as well, they were sensational. Thank you to them as well. And Julian and the Street Quartet, what a great job they did. Julian, great arrangements. Thank you, Julian. I'd also like to thank all the AMC volunteers who come along to all these events and work on the door, or work as ushers, or, you know, work around the stage, helping people make sure they get on stage on time. And we planned that this event would finish exactly at 9:15, and I think if you look at the clock, absolutely perfect. How's that? Drive home safely, and we'll see you again very soon. Thank you for coming along. Thanks also to the mixing engineers. Without them, these shows just do not happen. So thanks again, folks.